How many bottles you go through, man?
Well, you know, I had to taste it. Not a lot, man. Just enough. I mean, it's a high quality brand there. You can see there, beautiful box.
That's a pretty bottle you got there.
Yeah, and two, the thing about it, the taste is really nice, because most times when you have when you taste cognac, there's usually like an aftertaste.
Mm-hmm.
But here, you take it in, you receive it, and then you hear the first taste that you receive is okay, and then afterwards you use for a burn. The burn doesn't come. And I think that's what it is. So, like I said, it's made it, and literally it's legit, because if you don't have there's no cognac that's not made in France, okay? First of all,
right.
But then the fact that it's been in the States since December, some people might call it a little pricey, but XO is XO. So, you got to pay for quality. So, I mean, this is not those other ones. This is not the regular ones. This is not something called Irk and Jerk. You know, some other things. This is top of the line. And what I would do if I were you, let me show you that bottle one more time. If I were you, you know, since you know how they do with fights, mm-hmm. and you got the fellas get together and you make you all join in and price it, put a little money in. If it's the fight is $75, everybody put like $25 in, everybody get to see the fight. Same way with this, go and get you a little bottle, get you a little taste, get ready for the holidays, cause it's legit, man. And two, if you buy two or more bottles, you get free shipping. Also, too, if you buy a bottle, what we're going to do, we have a virtual experience coming up with the cognac, and we're going to take you through how to drink it, the proper foods to eat with it, and just a lot of fun things. And you get to meet a lot of cool people.
Where can they contact you?
They can contact us at www.lowe.imports.llc.com. L-O-W-E. ImportsLLC.com.
Welcome to Goon Squad First 40. Kumo along with Black Boar and Ice Water, running it down to you in October 12th. I think 12th or 13th. I don't know. It's the week of. Black wants the results of the picks. We're not going to do it yet because got a Monday and a Tuesday night game. He know the rules. After the games, we put out the results. I ain't putting out.
I bring it up.
But there's a lot of news. Let's get to it. NFL news. The first of all, let's not go to the eye test yet. Atlanta gets rid of their coach. Mm-hmm. They get rid of their coach, Ice. And we've been saying this for a couple of years now, that Atlanta Falcons have not looked like they're supposed to look. They try to do some fancy dancing with firing coordinators. That wasn't it. They went after the coach and general manager. Who do they have to fill in, or who do you think will be a great fit for that particular job?
Ooh, I think there's a lot on there, because they got rid of the general manager as well, which means that they're clean house pretty much, because the general manager brought in the last couple coaches. You know, and he's trying to make some different changes. I know Raheem Moss is in there now. I think he's like the defensive coordinator. He's the interim head coach right now. But somebody that might come in, I know they won't do it, but I think it would be fabulous if they did do it. He just had to get a defensive coordinator, particularly for the way that they're trying to – if they keep Matt Ryan and they keep with the weapons that they have, I think this would be a perfect – fit for Eric Bieniemy. I do. I know it's a little off center. It may not be happening right away. There might some changes need to be made. But from an offensive standpoint, you can't tell me Eric Bieniemy could not get that thing rolling. You just had to go get you a solid defensive coordinator, so he wouldn't have to worry about a lot of stuff. But he could focus on the offense and he could focus on the team in general. But he had to have, I think it would serve him best if he have a really quality staff. You need a lot of people that have experience, have been there before, so we can focus on this thing. But if there was going to make a move, and you know how Atlanta is, Atlanta would love to see Eric Bieniemy in that role.
All right. Like, what do you think, man? The general manager and the head coach is out. Now Atlanta has to start pretty much from scratch. They have some talent, but they really haven't been playing talented and inspired football for the last 5 weeks. What do you think about the move, and what do you think about you know, who could step in.
I think the move was needed, bro. It was really neat. I'm kind of surprised it made it this far, because last year they could have done this realistically and kind of maybe got ahead of the curve a little bit. But you talk about Super Bowl hangover. That's a hangover, bro. That's a year, two, 3 years hangover. And it seemed like the 49ers kind of going through the same thing. I wouldn't go – for me, if I was Eric Bieniemy, I wouldn't take that job. For him, I'd rather see him go to Houston, bro, just out of the quarterback. Because quarterback can get around. It's kind of similar to what he's dealt with in Kansas City. The offense, need a little tweaking. To me, Atlanta, man, is just I think the window has closed for them. I think their offense, Julio Jones stays hurt more than he stays active. I think they got to get someone in there that's going to be a grind. I can't even think of anyone. But they need a coach to come in and restore some old fundamentals. And they got to start punching people in the mouth, bro. They got to stop trying to be this high-flying team. Get yourself a good defensive coordinator, as I said. And kind of slow some things down, just play football. Because that high-flying offense and the talent, it just hasn't worked. And sometimes they get out in front and they just can't hold people down. So I want to see something different with them, man. I'm not sure who, but I like, if I was a head coach or assistant coordinator, I would rather go to Houston than go to Atlanta. Because that, to me, that team right now is in turmoil. You got to come in there and change the psychic of that team. Really come in and just kind of really massage the psychic. You don't have to do much in Houston, bro. It's not much to do. But I'm not sure. But I like the fact that the owner did both. Instead of just going for the head coach, he's like I said, he's cleaning the house, bro. Atlanta needs that big time. They need to just kind of start fresh and get it going. I would say bringing someone, it's going to sound crazy, but I would find myself a young assistant out of the college range that's been doing some things that maybe it's a no name. I always say this when it's time to hire somebody. Do your homework. Spend some time. Investigate. Interview. Try something different. Don't rush and go grab a name. And don't go get a rethread. don't go do that. Go get somebody that been, you know, that hasn't had success somewhere else, or maybe had a little success, but they haven't. They're kind of out of touch. Go find yourself a young guy that can grow with your team. Man, it may take a little while, and give it a couple years.
I almost kind of feel Black that Atlanta has to go opposite here. They got to go with an experienced coach that can settle them down and settle that organization down first before they go to somebody that out of the college rank. I'm not sure if an inexperienced college coach can come in and know the culture. And it has to be somebody who knows the NFL culture that they bring in to settle that team down, because that team has been kind of sporadic since that Super Bowl, and they never got it together from there.
I'll say this, man. If you look at some of the teams that are doing well now, look at the age of their coaches, bro. And if you don't even go to college or find someone, look at the Dolphins head coach, bro. Youthful. Look at the Rams. Youthful. Look what's going on in Cleveland. Youthful. Not a retread. Look what's going on in Cincinnati. You know, Cincinnati has a culture. But they're playing, bro. They're playing some gutsy football. You got to find some cats that are basically closer to the edge that can bring in some youthfulness. And that's what I'm kind of really seeing. If you want to go to college, find something different. Don't go get a retread, bro. A lot of these young cats are not going to listen to a retread. They're just not in contact with them. You know, find someone that can basically come and inspire them to be men and play hard for you. I agree they need someone to come in, but I don't know if it's going to be that older cat, bro. I thought about Brian Leftwich, in a sense. I'm not sure if he's ready to really, if that's a spot for him, because he has to come and really kind of mold him. And I do think he need to kind of leave where he is, because at some point he's got to step out his Bruce Arians shadow and do some things. But I don't know if he's ready to change the culture in Atlanta. There's got to be somebody that's young, innovative, and can come in and change the culture. Hit the ground changing the culture.
All right, so I'm going to give you last word on this. I was thinking about the coach Caldwell. Used to coach the Indianapolis Colts, used to coach the Detroit Lions. Someone solid, probably not a coach that's going to be there more than 3 to 5 years, but somebody solid to kind of bring this organization back to the basics and then kind of move forward, because this is going to be a rebuild for this team. It's not going to be something that maybe somebody newer is going to come in and really anticipate. And can they take all the losing at first when they come in with the Atlanta Falcons?
No, I agree with that. But see, my issue is twofold. Part of it is if you're going to keep Matt Ryan, you have to bring somebody in there that knows what the hell is going on. Mm-hmm. You have to. If you're talking rebuild, I don't have a problem with a new coach, somebody brand new from the college ranks or whatever. I'm good with that. But if you keep Matt Ryan, you have him under contract, and you keep the way you're going, you cannot expect him to just be around and keep losing. He's going to want to – you make the change. To get him to act properly and get him to play hard, you're going to have to bring somebody in that can make that happen. And that's why I mentioned about the enemy. It's a messed up situation, but you think about it. If you can get some of the guys still healthy, they have a lot of guys around there, and they just picked up some other guys as well, and you find yourself a decent running back. I mean, they've been working with a guy out of the Rams. If you get some healthy people, the enemy can make some things happen. But if you want to go another way, Caldwell, my problem with that is, though, it's going to take too much time, and he's a, as you mentioned, he's going to restore order, but you need pop. You got to have the combination of the two. He's going to restore order, but it's like you restore order, and then are we talking about the Detroit Lions, okay? You still need pop. You need pop. The league is moving. You're going to have an outstanding offensive coordinator then if you bring in Caldwell, because the league is moving. It's scoring a lot of points. They're not calling holding. They're not calling pass interference. They're letting the teams go crazy offensively. And the defense is really stagnant because you can't touch anybody. You can't make any plays. So whoever they decide to bring in, they have to be able to score points and use that offense. Again, the question I have is, if you're going to keep Ryan, it changes the dynamic of the whole situation. If you're going to let him go, start over, get your new quarterback, do what you got to do. As long as he's there, it's going to be a different type of he's going to be looking at it some kind of way.
Yeah. Let's move on to another story. Black, I think I texted you. I don't know if you were watching the game. You said you weren't watching the game earlier in our discussion before the show. Dallas and the Giants, I saw this as injury in real time. And when I saw it, I'm like, oh, he's done. And then I text both of you and said, Dak should have signed that contract. What do you think about Dak Prescott's injury, and where do the Cowboys go from here?
I think the Cowboys are in pretty good shape, bro. Based on the division that they're in, they brought in a backup quarterback that can be serviceable. If they can make some realignments and realize now you just got to run the ball, you're going to have to basically pound the rock, play some tight games. They have a schedule that's favorable for them, I think, the next four or five games that they should be able to kind of win. So it kind of gets them really a jump in that division. You know, I've said this numerous times, man, and I like Dak. I think he's done a lot to prove where he come from, to prove they deserve to be in this league and deserve to be reckoned with. But his head got too big way too soon, man. Asking for the money that he wanted and leaving guaranteed money on the table, bro. That's it right there. When you think about it, you know, playing NFL football or any type of football, you're one play away from being hurt. And they basically battled with them for months over money that, you, in my opinion, you weren't even entitled to. They were offering you a pretty decent contract, and he chose not to take it. And I seen people today getting mad at Jerry Jones. Huh? Jerry Jones is a businessman first, bro. I mean, he's a businessman. Why would he overpay Dak Prescott, anybody for that matter? If you were to give him the contract, this would be different. And I'm sorry, they can say all they want now. They want him here. Money talks, bro. At the end of the year, if this cat that's in there playing well, right, that's playing and plays well, he may never put that helmet on again. He may never put it on again. Unless he put it on for a serious discount. Let's be honest. Money talks. So he did himself a disservice. And, you know, I'm just going to drop this out there, bro. You know, I'm not one to say about karma, whatever that stuff they call, whatever it is. But here's a man that was steadfast against Colin Kaepernick and taking the knee. So I want you to see how well you was their lynch, you're their henchman. He said a couple of weeks ago, it should be an individual thing. I don't think we should be doing that. Let's see at the end of this season, the beginning of next season, how well they favor you when you decide to go out there and make those bold statements.
I know you and I talked about this yesterday, and I felt like he should have signed a contract, and now he's in a position where they don't have to franchise him. I know there's been talk about franchising him for another year, so he'll get back. I don't think they do that. I've been saying this for years. I see Dak Prescott with the Denver Broncos after he has a stint with the Dallas Cowboys, and it's kind of playing out like he's going to be somewhere other than Dallas. after this injury. Who knows when he comes back, is he going to be the same or better? Your thoughts?
Yeah. I mean, we can always guess and say, yeah, he should sign a contract. But you watch a guy like Kirk Cousins, he played, you know, he rolled the dice a couple times. You know, they franchised him, then finally he was like, all right, I'm going to leave now. So I understand it. Dak thought he could show the world he was worthwhile. He took a chance. He lost. He got hurt. I mean, that's sad, true, but it is part of football. Granted, he could have the guaranteed money, but I think he really wanted to prove to them that he was worth the $40 million. And maybe his head did get swollen. But like anything else, we know even in life, you take a chance, there's a chance you could fall or something could happen. And it did. So now you can talk about what could have been. It's now what is going to happen. So the question now is, he's guaranteed the money for this year because of the franchise tag. Next year, they're going to wait and see. Andy Dalton is going to play. Again, as you mentioned earlier, or it was mentioned earlier, the one thing that did come out of this, they had to run the damn football. I've been saying that for the last few weeks. You have to make Ezekiel Elliott a priority. All of a sudden, he's back. Did you see what he was running yesterday? After Dak went out, he bounced around, prancing around. All of a sudden, he's back. That was already there. So I'm going to look at the offensive coordinator. I'm also going to look at the coach. Now you have no choice but to rely on Ezekiel Elliott. CeeDee Lamb has proven that he's worth that 19 pick. He might be the best damn receiver on that team, seriously, even right now. And Dalton is going to be serviceable. That's all you need from Dalton. Their issue is on defense. But all we can do is I'm going to hope that Dak Prescott gets well, gets better. But as it's been said, if he comes in trying to demand big money, then I don't see it. And you know, people can be mad at Jerry Jones, but at the end of the day, like Thor said, he's a businessman. So you call him shrewd now because he made him. He said, I wish somebody would kneel and whatever. You can say what you want to about that. At the end of the day, this is about dollars and cents. He made a choice. He had to deal with it. And Dallas is going to do the same thing. They're going to wait to see if he comes back healthy, whatever it may be. And they're going to make a decision. They're going to make a decision. And if Andy Dalton plays well, they're going to have to make a decision. They probably will bring Dak back if he wants to come back at a discount. You ain't getting $40 million, bro. You're not, especially if they prove that they can at least move forward in the playoffs with him. Then the question is, who was the problem in the first place? Was it the coach? Was it the offensive coordinator? Or was it Dak Prescott?
Right, right. We're going to go to our eye test, Black. And I'm looking at the stats from the Cowboys-Giants game. You had Elliott, and me and Ice talked about this yesterday. When Dak went down, Dallas went to the run game. It was successful. They kept the ball out of the Giants' hands. Elliott ran 20 attempts, 91 yards, 2 touchdowns. CeeDee Lamb, 8 receptions, 124 yards. And they settled the offense down. They did not make Andy Dalton make mistakes. Start slinging the ball around. They didn't. They went to the run game. And they had another running back who was running the ball also, which I think salvaged the game for them. I don't know why the Giants give up the ball 1 minute to go and punt the ball back to Dallas. And you had a chance to get the fourth down play. I it's beyond me. But, Black, give me your eye test for the NFL.
I'm going to start with the Cowboys because I know we say this and we kind of bang our heads, they should run the ball. But, and I know you can say offense coordinator, but I'm going to look at the head coach, bro. He's doing the same thing he did in Green Bay. It's identical what he did in Green Bay. He just kept putting the ball in Aaron Rodgers and had a weak defense. They would fall behind Aaron, go win the game for us. That's McCarthy. That's who he is, bro. He abandons the run and at any cost. And I find it hard to believe that he's not having a voice. When he called the plays all the time in Green Bay, he doesn't have a voice in calling the plays with the Dallas Cowboys. So it's going to be interesting to see how long they're going to stay true to it. I know they played it or did it towards the end of the game, but they can't do that with consistency. I got to talk about the Raiders, bro, because the Raiders did it yesterday. And that game, when I first looked at it, I thought, nah, ain't no way possible, bro. Watching some of that game, you know, for some reason, the Raiders stood up as a team yesterday. They just did, man. Carr wanted to outdo Mahomes, and the most part, he did. It's hard to say that. His passes, and it's so funny because week one, he had the same thing. Then he kind of laid the egg a couple of weeks. But that team yesterday played with some spirit, and they got after the Chiefs, man. They got after. They had Mahomes running around like a chicken on their head, and he was hitting cats in the hands, and they were dropping it. Literally just dropping it because – They was getting popped earlier in the game. So they ain't want none of that, man. Miami. Oof. That's a game that I know I should have took.
Yeah. I thought about that one.
Oh, that's a game. Miami's coming, bro. Say what you want about this Flores head coach. He has this team tuned up. They are coming. And I know I said a couple weeks ago, I was thinking about putting two in. When they playing like that, they may not need him. When he comes in and he picks up and hit the ground, that's going to be a tough squad, bro. I know the head coach, he pulled Garoppolo out, and he said because his ankle. I mean, you can't do more to me to show me that Shanahan is not a fan of Garoppolo. He's just not. He doesn't want Garoppolo out there. It's just a matter of time. They got to come to terms and do something because he does not believe in him. He doesn't trust him. And the team sometimes moves the ball up and down to feel better without him. And I think he realizes that. He knew it in the Super Bowl. And I don't know how much longer they're going to hang on to him, but I don't see Garoppolo being there much longer. I'm going to say this, man. This is something I found to be bizarre. They didn't win the game yesterday. But Joe Flacco moved the Jets up and down the field pretty good, bro.
I don't want to hear you praising Joe Flacco.
I'm not praising him. Trust me, that is no praise. It's just watching and being objective. He moved that offense up and down the field. So it's interesting now. You look at even Washington, and you look at the quarterback that came back that was out for a period of time. He came back and played. I can't think of his name right now.
Smith.
Smith, I'm telling you this, man. He's got to be the most resilient guy to ever play NFL sports because when you think about Colin Kaepernick took your spot, he goes to the Super Bowl. You basically get a chance to go to Kansas City. Mahomes runs you out of town. You go to Washington and you get oh, my goodness, man. That's got to be tough to battle back from. But I'm going to leave it with this, and I don't want to speak on some other games, but I'm amazed now that quarterbacks that went in the first round, Haskell, the one in the New York Jets, these teams are ready to trade him already, but they're ready to be done with these quarterbacks. Get them out of town. And Washington wants a first round for Haskell. Are you kidding me? You'd be lucky you get a fourth round. I'll be honest with you, man. Just cut him.
Yeah, there's a report out that Washington wants to get rid of Haskins because him and Ron Rivera aren't seeing eye to eye. And it was basically a big statement that Ron Rivera said, you know what, I'm putting you in third string instead of second string. You're not going to see the field until we can get you traded. The games you mentioned about the Raiders and Chiefs, the Raiders, they hit the running game a little bit more than the Chiefs, and I think that gave them the edge in the game, too. Their defense went after Mahomes. They both had about the same amount of yardage. I think Carr had 347, Holmes had 340. Carr had three touchdowns, and that sealed the deal for them. But the Chiefs, I think their defense needs to improve a lot more. I was on the fence of who I was going to choose between San Francisco and Miami. I swear I was, and I kept looking, and I thought Garoppolo's coming back, the running back's coming back, all these players are coming back. Maybe they'll put it together and beat Miami. But when you have to bench Garoppolo after the second quarter and him throwing two interceptions, and it just went downhill from there. Maybe he's still hurt. I don't know. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. I said this yesterday with you. I think in Cincinnati, Green is going to be looking for a contract to get out of Cincinnati. I think he wants the ball and he wants to win. What's your eye test?
Yeah, I'm going to start where you guys were at earlier. Raiders, Derek Carr just seemed like he was a real quarterback. I've been thinking about that for a long time, and to beat Kansas City was no joke, even though Kansas City has kind of looked sluggish the last couple of weeks, but still a great win for the Raiders. Do not take that from them. Miami, I looked at those offseason transactions, and they're coming around. So, I mean, it was Fitzmagic yesterday, 350. Three touchdowns, but the team overall is playing well, and it's just a matter of time. I like them. I like the way they're moving along, making some choices. I think they're going to be better. And granted, Tua's there, but there's no rush. That I don't understand that. Just because he's young and everybody want to see him, the longer he waits, it's like in Green Bay. Ask Aaron Rodgers. The longer he waits, the better off he's going to be. So if they can keep moving along and not have to rush him in anything. Also, too, those that never had hip surgery, I have. The longer he can heal, the better. So you can play what you want to. I know he's an NFL football player, But the more you can heal with those type of surgeries, the better off you'll be. And I also had to just put that out there. You mentioned it earlier, but CeeDee Lamb, man, no matter who the quarterback is, let that man head the ball. He's a banger. They had a helmet-to-helmet hit yesterday when he caught the ball. He should have been on concussion protocol. He didn't worry about it. He caught it, got up, and moved on. They didn't even take him to the blue tent. He's a baller. He's ready to play. 8 receptions, 124 yards. And some of these older veterans that they're paying big money won't catch the ball. And he's like, okay, I didn't come here for that. I came here to play. All in the lovely following in the lead of others from the great 88. So he's making it happen. It's just good football. But now that we're playing, I think just more parity than we really want to acknowledge.
Yeah.
You know, you got teams like everybody's pumped about Pittsburgh. I still think they paper champions. And I'm not hating them because I'm a Cowboys fan. I'm just keeping it real. I think that they are not – I think they're good, but they're not great. And I think as we move forward, we're going to start to see some things. The same thing, too, about the Browns. You got a big game coming up Sunday, the Browns versus Pittsburgh. So somebody got to fall. So I want to see Pittsburgh against
– Grudge match.
But I just want to see them because, I mean, everybody getting all excited. You had the one kid catch, like, 9 touchdowns as a rookie or whatever.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I just want to see how it's going to all come down. But I think there's a lot more parity than people want to acknowledge this year in the league.
Black.
Kind of like our league, huh?
Yeah, whatever. Black, you had me sold on the Colts defense. They gave up 56 points in 4 games. Now, all of a sudden, the Browns are running up the score on them? The Browns?
Well, I say the same thing, man. I'm going to say this. I think the Colts made a big mistake in signing that quarterback from the Chargers, bro.
Oh, Rivers throwing 5 interceptions? Yeah,
Rivers
I would say so.
Rivers is shot. Get him out of there, bro. Get him out. He still think he's back with Gates 10 years ago, man. Get him out of there. He's letting it fly. And that kind of hurts your defense, too. I'm not going to say, but anything else about – I mean, one thing about Cleveland, man, when Cleveland runs the ball, their running game is something else, bro. And I'm not sure how much they ran it against Indianapolis, but you're right. They shred that defense up, bro. And they're finding ways now to start the game and getting O.J., getting Beckham into the plays and getting them out there and getting them involved. So they're doing something. Like I said, it's going to be interesting this week. I think Steelers will probably win this week. I don't think Cleveland's ready to take them over. But anytime Cleveland could be 3-1 at the beginning of a season, you got to start to pay attention. Something's going on there. They can run the ball.
Yeah, Claypool, the receiver from Pittsburgh Steelers, 7 receptions, 110 yards, 3 touchdowns. Rossenberger, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. You always like to see that if you're following Pittsburgh. Wentz didn't have a bad game. He had 2 touchdowns. He's trying to play some inspired football, but it's not just their attitude with the Eagles. They just stink.
I don't know if you guys noticed, Jalen Hurts came in the game a few times yesterday, man.
Yeah, he's been doing that all season. They've been working him in all season. So, yeah, one misstep from Wentz, or if he gets hurt, Jalen's ready. Jalen is ready to get in there. He's getting the speed of the game. They keep putting him in different packages. I like what they're doing. Let's go to NBA basketball, Black. And you were here last week talking about how Miami go beat up on the Lakers and LeBron and put the hammer down on them, put Haskins in. I ain't seen Haskins come in once. I already gave my congratulations to the Lakers. I didn't watch none of that stuff, the speeches and all that other stuff, the Lakers tying the Boston Celtics with 17 championships. I didn't want to see it. That's why I did my celebration early and congratulate them early because I don't want to see it. It was all set up, Black. What happened to Miami, man?
It seemed like to me the first game, Miami got out to a quick jump. And the Lakers at that point, for a while, took their heart. And we kind of noticed, or at least I noticed, sometimes your role players don't play their role when they need to play their role in big games. And I think Miami fell into that. I think some of their role players kind of disappeared. And it took Jimmy a big game of getting 40 points from the kind of step up. And then the next game, he went back to those role players. They just were never there. And I think the spotlight, and I'm not saying they were, I would guarantee them they beat LA, but I think the spotlight was just way too much for the Heat. It just was. I think they found it and they got there. And I'm not saying they choked, but they froze up a little bit and they kind of went away from some things that they probably could have done. Now I will congratulate the Lakers, but I'll just say this, man. It's part of the reason why I didn't really want to see the Lakers win. And to me, it's just they're making it out to be now. I saw something today that said this is one of the greatest championships for the Lakers.
Yeah.
I said, you gotta be kidding me.
You gotta be kidding.
I that's what I said. How? And then I think you sent something out. This right here just says it all, bro. Dwight Howard now is a Hall of Famer. But then again, I'm not surprised. Because anybody that make a make will be a Hall of Famer. I mean, how does Dwight Howard is a Hall of Famer? Like, he was a clown for 15 years. I mean, I'm just being honest with you. So this is the stuff that's going to go on now. You know, LeBron saying he wants respect. It's just now ESPN is going to take the hype and times it by 10 about LeBron. He's the greatest thing. He's better than Jordan. And that's what bothers me about this, bro, is that they're going to start to find things to say. They say Rondo's a Hall of Famer. Huh? I'll leave it there. I'll leave it there. That's what I just can't understand. I just, oh my goodness.
Right. The spoils goes to the victors, man. The spoils go to the victors. So now they can hype it up in the COVID Invitational Tournament. They're the champions, and now they can hype it up. I told you this was in the cards. This is the year of Kobe. Kobe 24/8 everywhere. They got the jerseys. They got Kobe's likeness. They did it for Kobe. They did it for – but I even heard some rapper I say they should give the NBA championship to Breonna Taylor's family. For what? What's that going to do? How does it help the family? Ice, give me your eye test on the championship.
Well, you know, like I told you, I tried to tell you to get ready. Thought I was looking crazy. Tried to warn you. Told Black Thor. You might as well – I told you that 4 weeks ago. You should go on and just go on and crown them. After the Clippers lost, I was like, yeah, Clippers didn't want to play. It's a wrap. But, I mean, kudos to Miami, though. Seriously. You know, I like Jimmy Butler, so that's no secret. But he got them there. And for those that say he should have played better, okay, yeah, he could have. But, again, I'll tell you, Milwaukee didn't get there. Two-time MVP. A lot of people didn't make it. They made it. There, I think their issue, though, was part of what was mentioned earlier, but – I think they got out tough as well in that finals because you had young guys. You had Johnson. You had a Hero. Guys like that were hitting those jumpers early on and everybody going crazy. They doing commercials on them and doing exposés and profiles on them. And when the lights came up, got tight. So they were playing – some of them guys were playing against grown men. Say what you want to. Rondo was like, you ain't never been here before. You had that. You had the – you know, Caldwell Pope was like taking people to the rack. Anthony Davis was like, hell nah, I'm not going to be denied. And you even had Dwight Howard was trying to talk some stuff. They just didn't have enough. And Jimmy Butler was trying to be a facilitator at times, playmaker. They were double teaming, sometimes triple teaming. He played hard. He gave all he had, but they didn't have enough. And I think this is going to teach them that they need some other soldiers. Bam played well. He tried at times. He had a lot of good flashes. But they need some other help. And the Lakers, that's why they kept adding these pieces. And you did this without even Avery Bradley. And they were still moving along. So I think you got to give major kudos to Rondo, though. And not just for the finals, but early on. Because when Rondo came on and was kind of, you know, he's the one person. If you watched him yesterday, they were clearly in the lead. They were going on, no problem. Rondo was the one guy that was barking orders even at LeBron. This is what we got to do to get this done. We have to complete this. And he really stepped up. I mean, granted, he seemed like he was older. You know, it was over the hill a little bit. But when they needed him, he rose to the occasion. And so the Lakers now are the champions. So, you know, it's all about Kobe. It's all these other things. They done had the pictures are killing me. Yeah. About the Kobe walking next to LeBron.
Yeah.
I'm like, dude, for real, man, let that man rest. Damn. I mean, it's too much for me. You know, it's like, you know, he's looking down on heaven. He's walking. He's smiling. Dude, let that man just, his family's grieving. Let him rest, okay? But the only thing I'm going to say is I am glad that we ain't got to wait too long and we're going to get started in late December or January because I want to see. You talking about, everybody talking about they want to make LeBron the GOAT? Y'all need at least two more championships, bro. You want to be the man? And I want to see what it's going to be like when Golden State returns. Denver coming back next year. Milwaukee hopefully to do something. Clippers going to make a change. They might bring Mike Brown in and do something. But other people going to be making some changes. Even Doc Rivers going to Philly. People are going to be hungry. Lakers not going to be hungry anymore. LeBron had a chance to take a year off. He was sitting quietly. That's why he said he wanted respect, because he was at home fuming. I bet you he's mad as hell. He couldn't play. He didn't make the playoffs. He'd been waiting, and he finally got his opportunity. Okay, that's behind us now. Now it's time. It's going to be even playing surface. Everybody's going to be moving forward. So I'm looking forward to it. I'm glad we don't have to wait a long time. Let's get back in it. I want to see it. I want to see now. I want to see the Utahs, what they're going to do. I want to see, what Miami going to make any changes. That like that. One thing I'm going to say, Miami, I'm going to tell you this real quick. One thing you might want to do, this dude's a free agent. You might not think it matters or he's not important. You better re-sign that damn Kelly Olynyk. That's all I know. You better re-sign that damn Kelly Olynyk, because he is a baller. And if you don't, somebody will sign him. Philadelphia, do you hear me? If they don't want him, that might be one of the first things you do. That dude's an animal, man. He don't care who he's on the court with. Sign that dude, because he's going to be he will produce for you in the postseason.
Yeah, Miami, I have to give kudos to them. I have to give kudos to Butler. That game when they won to take it to six, he gave all he could. And you knew after that game that I don't know much more he can give. When he was leaning over and just tired after playing 47 minutes in game five, he was just spent. So I have to give it to them. But they need more muscle. If they want to play championship ball, they need bigger guys, because it seemed like the Lakers just out-muscled them and out-big them. And so that's why they kept going through the middle, throwing the ball back, tossing the ball around, because the Lakers really had the middle and those mid-range shots all locked up. I didn't see too many mid-range shots. And when they did have mid-range shots, they were trying to do those floaters, and it just wasn't falling last night for them. So kudos to Miami. They outlast everybody in the East. The East got to come up and represent, man. If you're going to be – the East is like, come on, man. You know, you got the West just taking over. I mean, it's a battle royal in the West. The East is like, okay, who wants to go to the finals? That's basically what it is. So the East, I remember it was just flip-flop, where if you came out the East, the West was terrified of teams coming out of the East in the finals. But now – it's just not way that anymore. And I think Miami is a good spot for somebody who's big and wants to throw their weight around and put some muscle and become a defensive and offensive presence in the paint. They need some muscle, because they definitely got out-muscled and out kind of hustled in the finals. But I give them their props. They made it there. People thought Milwaukee, Toronto, Philly, Boston would make it there, but nobody saw Miami coming. And I give them their props, even though it don't count this year. But I give them their props. Well, what's next, Black? What's next? Who is in store? What do we have in store for next year?
That's the thing, man, because for me, I look at next year, and I can't even get excited, bro. I'll be honest with you, because it's going to be like a replay. I mean, if Atlanta, not Atlanta, if the Lakers kind of keep things where they have it, I don't trust Utah. I mean, let's be honest. Dallas going to look pretty, but I don't trust them. I mean, Houston, we don't know what the hell they're going to play next year.
Oh, I know what they're going to do next year. The same thing they did for the last three or four years.
You know, and the Clippers, I mean, even I threw the name out, Mike Brown. He's all right, but he's going to get them over the hump. Other than Golden State, what is really going to be different in the NBA? So I can't, you know, I think it's nice that basketball's coming back quick. It's not going to be a long break. But I can't look beyond it and go, because – I just don't see the teams are put together well enough or strong enough. And I'm going to say this, man. I when LeBron says, give him my respect, bro, all your champions have been Madden teams for the most part. You went to teams where you put them together like a Madden team. What respect is due to you? I mean, really, it's what you think about it. He went down to Miami, you put that together. You came back to Cleveland, you ran and got Kevin Love, you ran and got this. You go to L.A., they bring all these – it's like – if you can always spread, bro, you take all the players of the league and you put them on one team, you should win. You should win, technically. So what respect is he talking about? I mean, you have networks that just talk about you all day. Where's the disrespect? I'm just trying to figure that out myself personally. When you say they gave me my respect, what respect, bro? You have 4 or 5 months off to practice to to win the shortened league. I'll just say this, and I'll get out the way. I remember the year that San Antonio beat the Knicks that year when it was a short league. I think it was due to the strike. We don't even look back then and count that as a real championship. Why should we count this one as a real championship, bro? The Knicks had no place to be in that. So, I mean, I'm a Knicks fan, or I was a Knicks fan at the time. We had no place playing the San Antonio Spurs. We got spanked. And so it's like there really is no parity going on in the NBA. You got a bunch of fakers when you ask me, the 76ers included. And he's been feasting on that. So what respect do you do, bro? Take your championship, go home. Go drink some red wine.
All right, Ice.
Yeah. I'm not sure who's going to step up. I do like Denver. I mean, Denver still had – they need some pieces, and they got to make some changes in the offseason. I do like Phoenix. I like Phoenix a lot. I think Phoenix with another one or two players could really cause some damage. I think Portland definitely needs – they need some help down low. I mean, they're talking about trying to go, but you get back LaMarcus Aldridge. I'm not sure that's the answer. But you need to try to do some other things. So there's some pieces here and there. But I think if Miami – because they need to add somebody. I think once we start to look at making some moves, it might be good for them to make a change, and that might mean you have to trade somebody. Might have to trade one of them shooters. And people are like, oh, why would you want to do that? Okay, I'm with that. Sometimes you got to make a move, and you need somebody to help Jimmy Butler to work with that too. And I think now Miami's a little bit more exciting for somebody that might want to make a move. So with that being said, I like them. I like Miami a lot. Philadelphia. Good luck, Doc Rivers. Good luck with that one, bro. But I think if when I talk about Mike Brown, I'm not sure if Mike Brown is the total answer, but Mike Brown is at least a guy that can – he's an X and O guy, okay? He's not Doc Rivers. He's not this and that. But he knows how to put guys in the right scenario. When he was coaching LeBron and them, whatnot, he knew how to put people in the right place. And I think that's something that the Clippers may listen to him. The other thing, too, that the Clippers may have something that they have to move on, which why they might choose a Mike Brown, is because Kawhi Leonard and, of course, and Paul George are going to be free agents after next year. Everybody are not – a lot of people don't really care if Paul George stays one way or another. But they do want to keep Kawhi, okay? Kawhi, I think, wants to stay home. That's why he came out. He finally got home. Why would you want to leave again? Your family's there. Everybody's there. But the Clippers are going to have to give him a reason to stay. Which means you're going to surround him with a better nucleus, a solid head coach, somebody at least kind of see what's going on. And that might mean turning the team back over to him. So that means if Paul George stays, he's going to have to play that secondary role and understand that he's a secondary player. And if not, then they have to make some moves otherwise. But I think that's how it's going to go. I think the Clippers, I can't see – here's what I'm saying. I don't know if they're going to win it or not or how close they're going to be. I don't know. I don't think that's sitting well with Kawhi Leonard. Losing like that. Granted, he's been winning, but I don't think that's going to set well. So I think he's going to have a little oomph about him. And depending on what Golden State does, that's the other thing too. I want to see what they do with the draft. Do they pick, yeah. get out that pick, who they bring in?
Yeah.
Because whatever change they make, if they make the right change, then it's what it is. It's right back to what they're doing. But I'm very curious. You know, if you pick somebody like the ball kid, I don't see it. I mean, he's a very good player, but it's kind of like, as I close on this, it's kind of like the big fella Zion down in New Orleans. Everybody talking about how great he was, but you kind of saw it literally became him going one-on-one against the world. You got to learn how to play a little basketball. And the NBA is different. You just can't come in and run over people. And the same day with the ball kid, you have to learn that. Everybody's just as big as he is. You got to take some time to get better. I don't see him being a phenom like everybody wants to make these guys to be. It's going to take some time to work things out. But I'm looking forward to it. I'm ready to go. Let's get it back in. Back down in a couple weeks. Let's get it back.
I don't know if I'm going to be ready for it. But anyway, because I'm going to be watching college football, hopefully, if it lasts as long. But there were a lot of upsets last week. Most notable, Florida. Well, I thought Florida was going to be busting the SEC apart with LSU falling. They fell again to Missouri. Florida gets beat by Texas A&M. Alabama almost got beat, but Lane Kiffin got too cute and tried an onside kick and just changed the whole momentum of the game. Texas, nobody's talking about the coach at Texas, But Texas ain't been doing too well. They lose to Oklahoma, which was an upset because Oklahoma's not ranked. Texas is ranked 22. There were a lot of other upsets, but Ice, I'm going to hand it over to you. What is your eye test of college football? A lot of teams, I don't know if it's just lack of practice or that they don't really feel like they're in a real season, but there's been a lot of upsets in college football.
Yeah, well, I'm going to start with Oklahoma and Texas. Texas is right there on the edge. I told you before that when you look at it, both of these teams are, you know, they teeter totter. The one that falls off could be bad things happening. Oklahoma benched their quarterback Rattler in the first half because he was struggling. Yeah. Brought him back in the second half, brought him back, and he woke up. And I think that just says a lot about Lincoln Riley. It's like, okay, you need to settle down because if you don't, I'm going to put somebody else in. They came back. I watched that game, and the back and forth was wonderful, the drives and whatnot. I know Tommy Herman must just be shaking his head because it's like, man, no matter what I do, he has a lot of hype on him and they paid him a lot of money. He got a lot of money for the recruiting budget and they're falling short. So that's going to be a problem. But I like Oklahoma the way that they got that done. And then, of course, Texas A&M over Florida. Y'all keep talking about that man. Texas A&M said he wasn't going to be able to do anything. He wasn't going to win no games. Like, all right, okay, well, y'all just wait. But I like it because I think it's getting real good. It's going to be early on some losses, but I'm waiting for next week because the only game that matters next week is Georgia Alabama. So yeah, we're going to find out what's real.
Yeah. Black, give me your eye test on college football.
I'm gonna pick up on Alabama, man. To see Alabama defense give up that many points in the game, that's not Alabama football right there, bro. That's just that. I mean, that they score a lot, but to give up that much, that's not Alabama. So, like I said, the next week, the game to come next week to me is going to be kind of crucial. And it doesn't seem like the SEC is what they were. And like you said, I don't know if it's because it's the COVID or not. It doesn't seem like they're just tight like they were. Like some of the teams that – I know Texas A&M had an upset, but don't look like they're just ready. Like they're coming out and they're loose. And it's almost like they're playing preseason in a sense. And I know college people have a preseason, but it's not like they had enough time to really kind of gel and really get together. That Texas-Oklahoma game was a pretty good game. I'm not surprised Oklahoma won. I'm going to see how much longer this guy can stay in Texas because for some reason they don't have a tendency of kind of keeping a coach around if they're not winning and doing things down there because they love their college football down there. So it's going to be interesting to see. And I said last week, I think the coach of Oklahoma is just buying time, bro. I think that cat is out of there. I think it'll not be long. He's going to be – that's another name. I think it's going to come to the NFL. No one's talking about it now. But when the season get towards an end, that's another cat that's going to be coming down, coming back to – maybe coming to the NFL.
Yeah, because when Texas was his same record or a better record with Charlie Strong, they were trying to get Charlie Strong out of there, one or two losses out of there. Mm-hmm. I haven't heard that with Texas with this particular coach. I don't know if it's because he has the Ohio State pedigree. I don't know. And they're giving him more time? I don't know. But I'm just noticing that they are not – he is not on the on the hot seat as much as Charlie Strong was when he was struggling with teams in that conference.
I think he will be at the end of the season. I mean, you lost to Oklahoma. They played – they showed up. They played. They didn't get you know, manhandled. But I think in the offseason they lose a few more games. Oh, yeah. Yeah, the money down there is not going to keep having these type of seasons, bro. And yeah, they're just not going to keep having it. So, yeah, towards the end of the season, they kind of flake out a little bit. Yeah, that's when you're going to enter. The fire will start to come up some.
Yeah, looking at the rankings, you have Clemson still holding on to number one, followed by Alabama, Georgia. That's going to be a great game. Those two going to get at each other this weekend. Florida has to go against LSU. Boy, has the mighty have fallen. Oregon is mumbling down there. Don't know what to do with LSU getting hammered for the last couple of weeks. Notre Dame is number five. I don't expect them to be at number five very long. Ohio State, they play their first game on the 24th, and they play against Nebraska. Miami lost. Miami lost last weekend. North Carolina, ranked number eight. First time they've been ranked that high since the 80s, I believe. And so Mack Brown is doing a hell of a job with that North Carolina team. They're ready to play. They're scoring a lot of points. I just question the defense. They should beat Florida State this weekend. Also, Penn State's number 9 and Oklahoma State's number 10. I'm going to throw in Cincinnati, the Nasty Natty. They move up 4 spots. They play Tulsa next week. And then you have Oregon. Now, I don't know how you get ranked and you're not playing. They're ranked number 12. They're going to be playing Stanford on the 7th of November. How you get ranked and you're not playing until November? I don't know. Any other thoughts, Ice, on who you want to see other than the Alabama-Georgia game that might be exciting because you're going to have to wait till 8 p.m. Central time to watch that game. But who are you going to watch during the day?
You said, now, what was the game LSU is playing who, Florida?
LSU is playing Florida, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I want to see that because – even though LSU may not be that good, or people or the coaches saying they're not, I think they still have a little pride. And Florida's going to try to get back on track because this was supposed to be their year. Supposed to be their year with the quarterback. Everything's working well. And Texas A&M stepped up. But, yeah, I want to see that game simply because of the fact that it's a lot on the line. And, you know, you mentioned the Big Ten's not even playing yet.
No.
Well, you get 2 losses before the Big Ten start.
Yeah.
You might as well go and lay down somewhere. Because you said, Big Ten ain't even playing. Ohio State, number 6. They ain't even turned on TV yet. Yeah. They ain't even warmed up the barbecue pit. they ain't had a tailgate yet. And they number 6. And you lose 2 games? Come on, man. I'm just saying.
Sports.
Hey, I'm just saying. They know. They ain't stupid. What you going to make Ohio State 22? Everybody know. They know the game. How they waiting for just last year? They know. I mean, and there's so many other teams that have been waiting. So we'll see. I think it's going to be interesting, you know, Clemson doing what they do. But I'm going to say this on the last thing about for me for college football is the fact that, and you said it best, you talked about how Alabama, you guys had mentioned how Alabama got that many points scored against them. And when the coach, Nick Saban, come out and said, you think they had the signals? I was like, damn, you've been coaching 100 years. You never say that. You just say, you know what? We're gonna handle them. We handle business. When you come out and say, I think that man had my signals. He had my
question.
He had somebody on the phone finally telling me what we was running because that don't make no damn sense. I never heard you whine like that. I said, you whining? You know what? Oh my goodness! I was like, "Are you kidding me?"
Oh,
I think they have my signals.
Really?
Wow! Ooh,
that was funny.
Yeah.
That was funny. When he said that, I'm like, "What?" Oh man! But he was doing everything that that Saban wouldn't let him do at Alabama. I mean, everything. That onside kick was that really kind of messed up the game. Because they had Alabama on the ropes. I don't know why you get the momentum back. But here's some games I'm going to be checking out. Tennessee and Kentucky. That might be a good game. Got a chance to watch BYU last weekend. They're a good team, but they're not big enough. They're not fast enough for some of the Power 5 teams. But I want to see them play against Houston to see whether or not they can keep up with Houston. Any other games you want to check out, Black?
Mainly, I'm just looking at Georgia, Alabama, baby. That's it. I ain't got none of those on the barbecue other than that. Just get me to that game, man, because let's be honest, man. It's going to come down to Clemson, Georgia, and Alabama and anyway. Like you said, Notre Dame, how long are they going to hang on to number 5? If I'm not mistaken, Florida's what, ranked number 4?
Yeah.
And they lost, and Notre Dame doesn't even move nowhere? That's a, they're not taking Notre Dame serious. They just – right now, to me, they want these big names close to proximity of a possible chance of winning, but it's not going to happen, bro. It's not going to happen. So, yeah, Alabama, Georgia, I'll be ready.
I have to give Notre Dame credit. They did get into a conference this year. They did, you know, bite the bullet and get into the conference this year. But, Ice, we lost a number of –
they had no choice, though. They had no choice.
And they do play. They
do play Clemson this year, don't they?
Yeah, I think they have to play Clemson this year. Okay. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Continue on.
Yeah, we lost Joe Morgan today, baseball Hall of Famer. We lost Whitey Ford a few years ago, one of the greatest Yankees pitchers for the Yankees. So I want you to speak on those guys, man.
Yeah, Whitey Ford is dominating pitcher, man, and you know he came around at a time where You know, he was kind of a nasty type guy. You know, as far as the pitcher is concerned, when they let you pitch, and when you went to the great era of the hitters that were around that time, he still got the job done. And his numbers speak to the volume. Soft spot in my heart for Joe Morgan, man. I grew up, that's how I started watching baseball. I was a diehard Cincinnati Reds fan, and I was right there in the cusp when the Big Red Machine came through. So, you know, I remember the trade, literally, when I started watching baseball. Joe Morgan used to play for the Houston Astros, and the Reds made a trade. They traded Lee May, I think a guy by the name of Dennis Minke, and they got Joe Morgan. I think they also got Cesar Geronimo, and they all, that shift that they made, when they made that trade, it started building blocks for the Big Red Machine.
Right.
And he was a guy that was just a really good dude. Got a chance to meet him one time. He was always about trying to bring back African Americans to the game. As far as doing he was part of that RBI movement for Little League Baseball. Just a good dude and a hell of a player. And I don't think he really, even though he's a Hall of Famer, he didn't get a lot of the love that he should have on that Big Red Machine. And I'm gonna say this once, I'm gonna say it twice. You know, a lot of people, especially here in Ohio, want to make Pete Rose be the greatest Red of all time. You need to check the rest of them damn books, baby. Just because you play long, the hit king, don't mean you're the greatest Red. That's just a personal bias. They had some damn talent on that squad. Pete Rose played a long time, but he wasn't the greatest Red. Oops. No, I'm sorry. I mean, don't get some mail on that. I don't care.
10-time All-Star, 2-time World Series champion, 2-time NL MVP, 5-time Golden Gloves, and they retired the number 8. So when they retire your number, they retire, yeah, that clutch.
Yes, sir.
Try to do that.
Yes, sir.
He made the Cincinnati Reds and the Houston Astro Hall of Fame. And some numbers on Whitey Ford, 10-time All-Star, 6-time world champion with the Yankees, Cy Young winner, World Series champion, 3-time AL wins leader, 2-time MLB ERA leader. They retired his number 16. They're running out of numbers with the Yankees, so they might have to go into 100. They are retiring a bunch of numbers. But a buddy of mine was saying, hey, man, I grew up in that era watching Whitey Ford, even though he was a Detroit Tigers fan. He was like, I was a big Whitey Ford fan, loving the way he pitched. May those guys rest in peace. And we're losing a lot of them, Black. We're losing a lot of them, bro.
Yeah, we are, man. I'm not too familiar with Whitey Ford, so I won't speak of him. But I'm just going to say just a little about Joe, man, because to me, perfect gentleman. I mean, I named some things that doesn't surprise me. I've kind of heard some of it before. But I remember when he was a commentator, man, when he used to commentate the games, he just had a special way of delivery, special way about doing things, and he always kind of stood out no matter what he did. So a gentleman, bro, just a gentleman. And I did say last week we are starting to lose some of the great ones that when baseball was baseball to me.
All right. Ice, my Yankees, I told you before the series started that Tampa Bay has the Yankees kryptonite. And if they could get by Tampa Bay, I knew that they could pull off getting this World Series. But Tampa Bay took them to 5 games and snatched that 5th game. Now we have Tampa Bay and Houston against the LA Dodgers and Atlanta. I got to roll with my Dodgers. After the Yankees went out, you're like, oh, no, I don't want that. But I think it's going to be the Dodgers and the Astros, especially the Astros didn't have to face any fans, and that was going to be their biggest enemy this year. So I think it's going to be the Dodgers. People probably don't want the Dodgers to be back in the World Series and maybe choke again. But I think this is going to be.
Well, I'll just say this. We know the Dodgers have everything. The Dodgers are the Yankees of the National League, right? Everybody, you know, everybody, oh, yeah, you want him? Oh, he's hurt. You got a drug problem? Come on, you know, whatever. Bring him on. He's a hell of a third baseman, that kind of thing. So they're set. They've been set for a long time to win, you know, with the manager and whatnot. Everything is set for them. Question is, can they get it done? And I'm not sure about that. You mentioned about the Astros. Don't look good right now because Tampa Bay's up 2-0.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, they're up 2 games. So I'd like to see if the Dodgers make it, since it's here, let's make it Tampa Bay versus the Dodgers. I want the little man away to win. I told you before. I told you this. Tampa Bay was going to win the Stanley Cup. They won that. Tampa Bay going to win the World Series. and you're just lucky Tom Brady's people were not healthy. All three will cross. Tampa will cross the board.
Yeah. Is it fourth down or fifth down? I don't know.
That's all right. That's all right. Look, but I'm just saying, Tampa is a weird year. The wrong one. I'm just winning. Tampa is trying to get two, not three, but two. But I don't know. I think it's going to be good, but we need to see what the Dodgers are going to do. Tampa, I like Tampa Bay. They play that old school type baseball. They've beaten so far, controlling a two powerhouse team, beat the Yankees, controlling the Astros right now, and then they'll move on to perhaps play the Dodgers. So it should be exciting. But if I had to pick a team right now, since the Astros don't look like they're going to make it and Dusty not going to make it, I wanted Dusty to win.
Yeah, I want to agree with Dusty too.
It just shut everybody up, but if that's not going to happen, I'm going with Tampa Bay all the way, underdog.
All right. Black, I know the WNBA is over with, but you sent out a story that if you want to talk about, we could talk about.
Let me give you a little bit of what kind of why it's over, then I'll jump into it. But Breonna Stewart, man, remember last year she sat out and didn't even play? She had injuries out the whole season. Well, she came back. She kind of lifted Storm right up, and she lifted to a championship. The final game, she had 26 points and 4 rebounds. She won her second WNBA title and her second finals MVP award. You know, 33, they beat the last game. They beat the Aces by a 33-point margin, which is actually the largest in WNBA finals history. But here's something that's real interesting, man. I definitely wanted to get this out because game three, the coverage, and the ratings were up 34%. I'm not sure why, but it was up 34%, which says a lot. Yeah, what I sent you guys was a video of the coach of the Minnesota Lynx speaking on coming out and stuff of that nature, and her talking about how she grew up basically being a gay woman. And I think it's interesting because, you know, we talk about a lot of times why this league doesn't kind of flourish. And I'm not knocking what people's sexuality tend to be and what the case may be, but when you kind of just put that out there constantly to people, you got to keep in mind, you're turning some folks off, whether you want to or not. And realistically, and I'm not saying just shut up and play basketball, but you kind of, you're trying to get young girls to pay attention, you want their moms to feel comfortable with their girls following, paying attention, they may not be into that lifestyle, they're going to be reluctant to pay attention. And when you have a coach such as her, coming out clearly, giving you a life story, and I'm sure to her it sounds like a case of liberation. But you got to keep in mind, at the end of the day, this is a sport and it's a business. So who are you basically turning on and who are you turning off? Because I guarantee you, for the most part, women that are feels her sexuality, because she come out and say that, they're not turning and watching anymore. They're not. But women that don't identify with her sexuality, hears that story or sees that, they may turn out or may not turn in.
Yeah. What's your thoughts, Ice?
Yeah, it's just tough because, I mean, when you talk about sexuality, there's a way to, if you want to do that, you want to talk about you're proud of who you are, that's great, but it does not have to be swayed all the way over here, right? Because if it was heterosexual and it was over here and it'd be like, oh, you don't, not room, leaving room for people, you know, from on the other side of the scale. So I think they do overemphasize it a lot. I know that, I think it was a game too that, after Sue Bird had, what, those 16 assists or something like that, too. They pumped that up a lot, and people wanted to see a Stewart. And she is a baller, bro. She's somebody you can take to the park, and she can hold her own. I watched her when they won it 2 years ago, and I was amazed just by the way she has no fear. I think they played, what was that? One of the series they played, I think, against Phoenix with Griner.
Right,
Yeah, and she was like, don't nobody care about you. You just big. And they were playing. I was like, the way they moved the ball. So I think, too, that the WNBA, they're going to do what they do. But I think, too, that it would be very helpful if they kind of gave equal time to people that are maybe not gay. Because there's a lot of girls that want to watch basketball. They love basketball. But, you know, you're not gay. Like, for instance, what is it, the guard for used to play for Notre Dame, the girl, the African sister, and did her well this year and led the league in scoring. I didn't hear enough about her.
No.
I didn't hear enough about her. She was balling. I didn't hear enough about her. And I don't know if she gay or straight, but how come I couldn't hear enough about her? I didn't even know what damn team she was on. I want to hear about that. And I think you equalize it out there. She's somebody some people could follow, and she was leading her team as a young person. That's when you kind of mix in the marketing sense. You mix a little bit of both of that. You want to talk about people being gay and they're liberating themselves and being free. I have a problem with that. But mix that in with something else too. So, because there's some other people like to do that. Nothing wrong with the pride movement. I'm cool with that. But let's mix it in a little bit because everybody's not gay.
Okay. We're going to move into questions from the squad. Black, first question, man.
I sent you guys a story, and it kind of piggybacked on something I talked last week, a question I talked about. But it was a story out, and it's funny because I even hear about this. I found it on the Peacock, and you brought up Michael Smith from ESPN about a few months ago. What is he doing? Mm-hmm. He's on Peacock, man. He has a show that's with another cat, man. The show is pretty strong, so you guys get a chance to check it out. You can't check it out. But they had an article about the Wichita State coach, Greg Marshall. And I sent it to you. And my point is, he's accused of basically punching one of his players in the face, using racial slurs, all this other stuff. In this day and time, how is that permitted to go on? And you don't even see that on headline news nowhere.
Ice?
I'm not sure. I mean, one, because it could be of his reputation and people are trying to hide that. They do that a lot, AKA Bobby Knight. But yeah, they do that a lot. But I don't know. I guess whatever the evidence, I wonder if there's video on it. If there's video, there's probably no issue, no problem with them bringing it out and showing it firsthand. But he's been there a long time. And a lot of times those groups, particularly alumni groups, they really like you. They stick hard, stick to your heart, and they'll do everything they can to save his job. But if you're wrong, you're wrong. It should be coming up. But again, NCAA clearly shows you if they have a product or somebody that they think is good and it's not a lot of evidence, they just kind of keep waiting, and sooner or later you forget about it. And then before you know it, another season. Here we go. March Madness. Let's go. That's what they do. So if that's the case, is it the truth, somebody, this really happened, then they should look into it and dive into it and remove him. If that's what is needed.
I think it's a case of, and we see this a lot in college, money over morals, man. And he coaches at Wichita State. That's a very successful program. He makes a lot of money. He brings a lot of revenue. You don't hear Wichita State in football. You don't hear him any other time, only NCAA basketball. And I think sometimes that the money motivates and it's over moral. So they will tend to hide things that are indiscretions from the coach, as opposed to really kind of doing what's right and getting after the coach and getting after the players, because the player or the coach controls the basketball team. And keep your hands out of it, keep your business out of it. We control this, never mind here. We're making you money. You sit there and you shut up and you just count the money and give me my check when I need it. So I think it's morals, money over morals most of the time. And just like with Bobby Knight, if you ever watched the documentary, he became so powerful in Indiana. I mean, even after all the transgressions, you still have folks following him, wanting him to stay, all this other stuff. It's just crazy. It's almost like a cult following. With some of these coaches. But think about it. The only other coach in Kansas that's bigger than him is Bill Self. And you see what the NCAA has done with him with all his transgressions. Nothing. Black?
I don't know. I'll say this first and I'll get to my other point. If there is a rumor that you punch my son, being an alumni alive that's going to protect him as a head coach, bro. I'm just saying. There was not an alumni alive that you can punch my son or talk to my son with that disrespect, and I don't come to college. I don't come to Wichita State and see you personally. I don't care how much money you make. And I think that's what happens here, is that we get lost in how much money being made and all this type of stuff. And you're right, it's a moral thing. But at the same time, these young men that are sitting and being subjected to this, no one has a gun to your head to play, bro. No one. And in life, you got to realize sometimes, you know what? Walk away. At the prime time, when you're supposed to walk on that court, walk away. if they're not doing right by you. But I think even when I'll say this real quick, even when you look at what happened with the Big Ten with football, they were trying to do the right thing when it came down to the COVID. They were trying. And look how the parents gave, not the universities, the parents gave the Big Ten hell. Parents. So it's almost like as parents, we are basically pimping our kids, pimping them to get something that they think they rightly deserve. And that's the sad part about this. That's my opinion. That's the sad part.
Yeah. All right, so what's your question, man?
Yeah, I sent out, I think put something on Facebook as far as the show, Goon Squad show. And it was about the 1968 Olympics. And what it talked about was Spencer Haywood, of course, who played in the NBA, played overseas, you know, world-renowned man of leisure, along with other things. So he talked about how the experience was, because he's on the 1968 men's basketball team, talked about the experience between what happened with John Carlos and Tommy Smith, of course, who were ostracized from the Olympic Village and moved on. And then he talked about how there was almost like a certain kind of haze over the Olympic Village, particularly for African-American athletes, as to you don't want to get involved with this. It was kind of like they were warned, and it's almost had people scared and whatnot. So my question is, what do you guys think about that? Because for so long, they made Carlos, and Smith villains. And all they did, they stood on the podium and they held a black glove up, recognizing themselves as American, but as also as black Americans.
I have some comments, but I saw that documentary that I think you're speaking of, Black.
Realistically, how long was that? You said 1968?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Kaepernick took a knee, 4 years ago? Mm-hmm. There was a haze then. I mean, what's different? No one, NFL players did not want to join. They shunned him. NBA players shunned him. Some baseball players I don't understand the difference. So to me, Spencer Harris is saying this, it's sad. It's pathetic that you would think that at a time, I understand that back then, that there was a haze. It was 1968, so yes, I get that. 2015, 2016, 2017, 2018, we still got a haze? No, we got cowards as black men. That's what we got, bro. That's what we got. It's not a haze. We got coward. We got guaranteed brothers making guaranteed money that are walking around the haze. That's what that is. I'm sorry.
I know I was watching a show about this with Spencer Haywood, and correct me if I'm wrong, Ice, it almost seemed like, to me, Spencer Haywood saw himself making a business decision rather than a decision on civil rights, things of that sort. And it's almost like those athletes who have futures as pros were kind of faced with the question of, do you want to make a good business decision? Or do you want to follow this route and lose your opportunities to play in the NBA or any other league or be renowned as an Olympian or a great athlete? And so even though that was the case, I still wasn't really kind of happy in the way he chose to kind of not address it and not kind of follow what the two brothers did in the Olympics. But correct me if I'm wrong. It just seemed like to him, it was a business decision for him.
No, I mean, you're right on point. And that's what was interesting about it. The fact that, you know, we always talk about, you know, people standing up or people not standing up. But at the end of the day, when you don't have masses, when you stand up with one or two, then there's a way for them to ostracize you, what they did to them. And then all of a sudden you want to come back later on and now you want to give them a statue. I mean, it's ridiculous. The whole Muhammad Ali thing, too, like he did something totally wrong. But then again, you know, Black Thor mentioned about Kaepernick. Only thing I'm going to say about this, I get that. But my problem, I always said it. And we always, this is the problem that I have with this. We make excuses for these football players. I said it before. Okay, they're kneeling. That's bullshit. If you really care about Kaepernick, give up a check, bruh. Give up a check. Then you down. Even this boy Reed. You really care? Lose three weeks of pay. then you down. Otherwise, you don't feel this pain. I am so tired of us saying, oh, yeah, we really down. You know, we talk to these people. Nah, bruh. If you care, give up the cash. You're not going to do that, though. And that's what the owners always said. One of the owners even said when they thought they were going to strike, he says, we know the one thing we don't want them to do, African-American players to strike in the NFL, because it destroys everything we're doing, our supporters, our advertisers, our fantasy football, the whole nine. He said, we were like, oh, man, we got to do something because we don't want them to strike. But then they took a step back like, wait, man, hold up. They ain't going to strike because they love their money too much. And that's the kid. That's the truth. It's always been that way. But we don't talk about that. Oh, we talk about what they're doing, how much money they got to help back in the community. At the end of the day, the top five in African-American players were the standout when it was relevant. It's not really relevant now because they done moved on. But five players stand out, stood to take off 3 weeks, the NFL owners would do anything they wanted. But nobody's going to do that. And I ain't mad at you because you got to take care of your wife, and your life, and your baby mamas, all that. And you don't want to see Cobra. I got that. But at the end of the day, still come down to you really not standing with that man. I don't want to hear that no more. I don't want to hear standing with that man, lose the check, and you're not going to do that. So let him stand on his own accord, and that's how it should be.
Cool. I have a question thrown out there. I sent you all a video of Deion Sanders, and he's on this talk show. And I didn't realize that Nick Foles had a nickname, BD Nick, which is catching on in Chicago, of his coolness and his bravado on the football field. Have any of you heard of his nickname in the locker room?
I'm going to respond to that, bro. I don't know when we sink to the point where we're going to follow up with something like that, bro. So that's a question that you bored me with. I'm not going to try to figure out what you and Deion
Sanders can enjoy that. I'm going to say this. You my man. We went to school together. And you know, we had some good times together. But I don't give a damn. I ain't going to be right talking about your anatomy, bro. I don't care how much you owe me. You ain't gonna ever hear that shit come out of my mouth. So I don't know what they talking about. I don't even want to know nothing about that. And if it is true, I'll be damned. I'm gonna go around talking about, yeah, that's Big DD. What's up, D?
Because Mac almost said it on air here after the game. And I'm like, whoa, this must be really true.
And if it is, why you talking about it?
I mean, the nickname. I don't care about, you know, whether the nickname.
What's the nickname? Let me ask you this. What's the nickname mean?
That he's brave and, you know, he got a lot of ball.
Yeah, right. Okay. Okay. Whatever. No, okay. That's what it means. Yeah. He's brave, right?
Okay. Yeah, he's brave.
Yeah, okay.
That's all I want to know.
I'll just say this. Any man that goes on a show and talk about another man like that, I question that man, bro. I question that man.
It's not often I agree with him, but I do on this one.
Last second shot, Black.
I'll go back to the question I had about the coach of Wichita State, man. It's time that parents realize that, you know what, if a kid doesn't make it to the pros, you can't sacrifice and stop pimping them. We see it all the time, man. There's no way in the world any man should be putting his hand on your kids and you think it's the better of your kid. I'm sorry, none. Like I said, Wichita State University would not be big enough if that was my son. If I heard it happen to my son. There was one, if you guys into the story, there's one guy that came home, was depressed, and stayed in his basement. And his father talking about he's depressed. What type of father are you? Realistically, that's what we've come to. I'll leave it there.
All right, last second shot, guys.
Yeah, I was going to talk about a few things. I'm going to apologize, first of all. If you're not an alcohol drinker, I'm going to apologize. But if you are, we got a sponsor. Sponsor called Rayon Cognac. It is an African-American, produced by an African-American company, doing some great things. I suggest that you check it out. It's really good. If I was you, I'd check it out. It's XO, top of the line. If I was you, I'd check it out. It tastes real good. If you like cognac, it's a pretty bottle. See that? Time's up. Thank y'all.
If I was you, I like that.
If I was you, I want to be me too with that bottle. And when I get mine, I'm going to be showing it off too. I'm going to leave it there. I ain't got no last second shot. But check our bonus material because he's going to be talking more about the cognac once we finish this show. Going to put in the bonus material. I'll put it in the beginning of the show and talk about the cognac for those who want to see it.
But Low Imports, LLC.com. Low Imports, L-O-W-E, Imports, LLC.com.
And this is great.
Tastes good. Rayon Cognac, African-American brothers. Getting it in. Only one of three African-Americans in the United States to produce his own cognac out of France.
Hey, Kappas, you better represent. That's your brother putting that
exactly. out. Join the Masons, too. Masons, too. You
Kappas, represent.
Yeah.
All right. We will catch you on Wednesday where Black will find out who won last week's pool. It was a three-way. It's going to be a three-way tie because all three of you picked the same game. So it's going to be a three-way tie. So, yeah.
Oh, you didn't pick? You losing again?
I picked Jacksonville to upset. Should have picked Miami and Chicago if I had any sense. But, yeah, I picked Jacksonville. So, we'll talk about it Wednesday. We'll give
I love them Texans.
Texans, oh, man.
Romeo.
Pat Romeo won a game for the Texans. We'll see you Wednesday on our NFL Picks Week 6.
Get you get goes well with cigars too, bro. Get your humidor.
Oh man, I miss being around cognac and whiskey and cigars, man. It's been so long. It's been so long. It's been so long.
Damn, if we get that Don Dance back, huh?
Oh my goodness. You ever have a good cigar with some whiskey or cognac, man?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Black.
No, I can't say I have, bro. I don't do cigars, man. I just
Do you smoke at all, man?
Nah, bro. These lips are made for other things.
Chicken.
You got to your imagination.
Well, look, long as you didn't say D, we good, huh? You feel me?
That's the one thing right there, baby.
Long as you didn't say D, we good.
That nickname is spreading like wildfire here, man, because people found out his nickname, and they just going wild with it.
Look, I'm going to call him like his mama called him. I'm going to call him Clay.
Mama called him Clay?
I'm going to call him Clay.
Check where the fires go, brother. That's all I can tell you. Where the fires go, you may not want to go there. Watch the flames.
Mama called him Clay. I'm going to call him Clay.